Hey, Pastor Steve Waldron, I hope you're having a great day in Jesus. I'm with New Life Church, Albany, Georgia. We're in the book of Matthew, the tax collector with Simon the Zealot, the anti-tax collector, all in one group with Jesus. But we're talking about John the Baptist right now and the baptism of Jesus. And so we're at John chapter 3, verse 15, and it says this, "And Jesus answering said unto him," John the Baptist, "suffer it to be so now." Because John the Baptist has been going around prophesying about the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You know, John the Baptist, not recorded, saw a lot of miracles or anything, if any, in his ministry. But at the same time, he was a great man of faith. He was like, you know, God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. So had a lot of faith. He knew about the baptism of the Holy Ghost, the essentiality of it. And so, you know, Jesus comes to get baptized, you know, half first cousin or whatever it is, you know. I used to love when Carmen Licciadero would talk about John the Baptist and Jesus, you know, playing together as kids, because John the Baptist was about 6 months older than Jesus. You know, John the Baptist, he would be, you know, kind of saying, you know, would have all the Roman soldiers around playing, and then Jesus just come, you know, wipe them all out. And so, you know, so who knows if that may have happened? I don't know. I know some of the Gnostic Gospels have Jesus striking people blind, turning clay pigeons. I don't think any of that's true. All right. "For thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness." So Jesus is saying, I don't need to get baptized. It's for the remission of sins. We find that out from Mark 1. Even John's baptism was done, a video, I think, a year or two ago on what that meant in a pre-blood, pre-Jesus name context, the remission of sins. Or was it pointing back or pointing, you know, in order to obtain remission of sins or because your sins were remitted at repentance, which I don't think is the case. But be that as it may. And what formula did John use? There's so many neat things about John. I mean, archaeologists are finding like some of the best-selling books in religious history in the last, you know, few years have been about John the Baptist and finding John the Baptist and the existence of mikvahs all over the Holy Land, which he would be baptizing in the Jordan primarily. But, you know, you have disciples of John in Ephesus 20 years plus after the day of Pentecost. Pretty amazing stuff, Acts 19. So then he suffered him. So John the Baptist is baptized. Could you imagine baptizing Jesus? I'd be like, come on, you know, no, I'm not going to do this, you know, but okay, you tell me to do it, of course I'm going to do it, but, you know, God incarnate, you're baptizing God in flesh. And Jesus, when he was baptized or completely immersed, not sprinkled, completely immersed, went up straightway out of the water. And lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. Now, in John chapter 1, this was an identification of the Messiah, that God had told John the Baptist, how you're going to know the Messiah is whosoever you see the Spirit of God coming like a dove and remaining upon him. Now remember in, what is it, John 5:37, Jesus says to the Pharisees he's talking to, "You've neither heard his voice nor seen his shape at any time." Talking about God the Father. So the Spirit of God, we know of one God the Father. This is the Spirit of God according to John 5:37, 1 Corinthians 8:6, coming down. But isn't Jesus supposed to be God incarnate? I think it was Finis Dake and maybe some others, they were called adoptionists many centuries ago, millennia ago, that said Jesus only became the Messiah or became divine at his baptism. No, he had the Holy, he was from his mother's womb, he was filled with the Holy Ghost. He was God incarnate from his mother's womb. But since God is omnipresent, he is able to be on the throne, coming down like a dove and existent fully in Jesus dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. We're complete in him. When we've seen him, we've seen the Father. Remember, Jesus himself would repeatedly say, "It's the Father in me. He doeth the works. The Father, he speaketh. The words that I speak are not my own. They're the Father's So he was the Father incarnate, but that doesn't mean God wasn't on his phone, on his throne, on his throne, and able to do anything. Just like God can be in me, God can be in you, God can be in people around the world, and still be on the throne, because he's kind of like omnipresent. He can do these things. And so that's just, and so a lot of people see a Trinity here. It's kind of almost sad or humorous to me. I've done like multiple videos showing how that's definitely not the case. And obviously, we do a lot of videos here. You may not know that. We've done almost 4,000, I think, coming up on. And you know, a lot of teachings and stuff. And so not everybody's seen every video, but it seems like you just have to start over every video, because somebody will just get introduced to the channel for the first time, and they're just like, what about the baptism of Jesus? Well, the baptism of Jesus proves the Trinity. I'm like, where'd you hear that? Oh, is the word Trinity mentioned here? Oh, no, it's not mentioned here. It's not in Mark, not in Luke, not in John. Oh, it's nowhere in the Bible. You know. And so Jesus was a monotheistic Jew, John 4:22-24. He says the Jews had a correct understanding of God. They believed in one God who is a spirit. God is a spirit, not three spirits, not three centers of God. God is a spirit. Did a video on that a while back. And appreciate some of you really liked that video. And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, humanity. Remember Luke 1:35, therefore that holy thing that is born of thee shall be called the Son of God. Why? Because the Spirit of God overshadowed Mary. That's why it's the Son of God. Son means the incarnation, the humanity, the you know, some combination, but it's also God, thy throne, O God. To the Son, he saith, thy throne, O God. So it's proper to say that the Son is God, but the Son primarily refers to the flesh or the incarnation, God in flesh. And so the flesh of God is not God. Only the God inside, the Spirit, is God. And so he's the Father and Son in one person. And so that's, you know, 1 John 2:22-24, that in Jesus is both the Father and the Son. He's, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God. The Son's name is Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. All right, so but people say, they're like, well, so then would you use the term God the Son? No, I wouldn't, because it's nowhere found in Scripture. So it's not a scriptural term, because that would give the implication that the humanity of Jesus is somehow God. And it's not. It was sinless flesh, but it's not. It wasn't divine flesh. It had real flesh and blood. It was the Son of David, the Son of Abraham. There's genealogies. There's lineal descents here. All right, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. Then was Jesus, chapter 4, verse 1, led of the Spirit into the wilderness, that same Spirit that came down. Another place it said it drove him into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. Again, another place it said he was tempted of the devil 40 days, and he's fasting this whole time. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungered. Now people say, well, Jesus being God, he wasn't hungry before that. No. The normal human body, of course, you get very hungry after about 3 days, but then it's like self-discipline takes over, and your body eats up all its fat stores till about the 40th day, and then it begins to eat its flesh, its bone, and I'm not using the proper term, muscle, sinew. Terminology, it begins to eat of itself, searching for nutrients because it's about to die. And so after 40 days, and so they say those, I've only fasted 21 days, most I've ever fasted, that's times of intense hunger. Now I've done a 40-day fast of one meal a day. I may have done that once or twice, I don't remember, but I've never done, you know, a total fast, and even like 21-day fast. Of course I did liquids, I did water, those type things. And so And I'm not, I'm just point of information, not bragging or anything. But so that's what it means afterward and hunger, because I've had comments on the channel. People are like, well, that's kind of sketchy, but it's not. It's just biology. Verse 3, and when the tempter came to him, now the adversary, know your adversary, that old serpent, the devil, the tempter, there's all kinds of names, more subtle than any beast of the field. He's the tempter. So Satan's always going to be tempting you. He said, if thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. So notice he attacked Jesus where he was weakest. John the Baptist had already said, God can make of these stones children of Abraham. So he's like, I know you know that he can of these stones make bread. Command that. But he answered and said, it is written. The living word quoted the written word. They're the same thing, really. Jesus, when he comes, Revelation 19, he's got a name on his vesture, the Word of God. That's the reason you need a pure Bible, because if you don't have a pure Bible, you're going to get an impure Jesus if you're not careful. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Notice this, he quoted all three times from the book of Deuteronomy, the second law. Also, not by bread alone, you have to eat, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. He's saying that this book, the Bible, proceeded out of the mouth of God. And notice, you should live by every word. Some of you that proof text your way through the Bible, be very careful with that. It's good to be able to show people what you believe, apostolic doctrine, those wonderful things. But you, how you live is by every word. So if you're not distressed by modern Bible translations removing many tens of thousands of words, or if you somehow think the King James, the Bishop's Bible, the Geneva Bible, and the great Bibles of the Reformation and the Luther Bible all added tens of thousands of words, which nothing could be further from the truth, and that can be shown empirically, and I've done that numerous times, as has many books, very scholarly tomes. To live, you've got to have every word. Now we're going to stop there and enter back in right in the middle of Jesus' temptations. But God bless, live for Jesus. The devil comes at you, start quoting the Bible, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Amen.